I used to break a lot of valves by pumping them up in a bit of a semi-rage.
You might want something that's going to nail it when you pump it up, and you're going to get cold if you're there going, giving yourself RSI. Go, oh, gosh, so painful. So if you're shopping for a mini pump, there's every chance you're on the website and you've got a whole array and you've sorted them from cheapest to most expensive, because what other way is there to sort them? And now you're wondering which one to pick. So we think that there are some key features that you should look out for and maybe eliminate some off that list. So, Benji.
Right. First question. What size is a mini pump?
It depends what bike you're going for. Now, obviously, we are talking about mountain biking mostly, but some of us ride gravel bikes and some of us ride other sorts of bikes too. Mm. Other bikes are available. And so one thing with mini pumps is that the volume of them, the amount of air that they push out, might matter depending on whether you've got a great big mountain bike tyre.
Okay, yeah.
Or a road bike tyre.
Right. Okay.
Now, a mountain bike tyre, you're going to have to get it up to, at very most, 40 PSI, maybe if you're, like, reseating something.
Yes, if you're born pinch flatting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whereas a road bike tyre, you're going to have to get it up to 120 or something like that, aren't you, maybe?
Depends how old you are and what size of your things, isn't it? There's still some old schoolers running 21 mils with 100 and something, but I think most modern things get up to about 80, don't they?
Yeah.
Road tyres these days, 28.
So you're doing like a trade-off between the size of the pump, the volume that it's outputting, and then the pressure that it's going to get up to.
I suppose, is it that it's going to be portable size?
Yeah.
Is that right?
So you're going to have to take it with you in your bag.
Yep.
But then even that might depend on, like, if you're going off into the back of beyond, you might want something that's going to nail it when you pump it up, and it's going to get it over and done with quickly, because it's peeing it down with rain and you're going to get cold if you're there going, giving yourself RSI. So, for example, something quite small like this, you're going to have to do a lot of rapid pumping to get a big volume mountain bike tyre up to...
That's probably as small as you can...
It's just about as small as you can get.
Pretty much go on a mini pump.
Whereas...
And there's no valve locking on that.
Well, we'll come on to that one.
Okay.
Yeah. Whereas this one, great big pump, and it puts air in both on the in-stroke and the out-stroke because it's got, like, a double chamber in it.
Right.
So you're going to get pumped up a lot quicker with that, but you've got to carry it around.
And you get massively tired a lot quicker with double pumping pumps, in my experience.
Oh, OK. Well, whenever I've loaned this one out to people, they've been like, whoa, that's really good.
Yeah.
So... Yeah. So that's your trade-off then with, you've got to get up to whatever pressure, and that's probably fine for mountain bikes, but if you are going to use it for a road bike, then you need to check what the maximum pressure it'll get up to.
Pressures, do you want a gauge? Is it worthwhile? There's one on there.
There's one on there. So this is this pump is a dual function pump.
Okay.
It's to do shock and tyres.
Okay.
So it has a little adjustment on the bottom between high pressure and high volume.
Okay.
So you don't have to make the choice.
Right.
However, it's a bit of a compromise, to be honest, that it sort of doesn't really do your tyres that well.
Okay.
But it does have a gauge on it, which, particularly on a shock pump, I guess, is kind of useful. But the gauge has got to be useful. So this one goes all the way up to 300 PSI,
quite high,
which it needs to be for a shock, but it doesn't need to be for your tyres. And that means that the scale, as you get up to your tyres, like 20 or 18, like, you can't really tell the difference between 17 PSI and 20, but you can when you're riding.
Right.
So, gauges, meh.
Yeah. What other features are going to be useful then?
Well,
aside from inflating them.
Depends, again, what bike you're using. I like to have a pump that does both Presta and Schrader because I ride a BMX.
Right.
So and also my cargo bike has Schrader valves.
And you can save someone else's day as well.
Yeah.
Which is always nice.
So so how pumps do that varies. Like, this one is super easy and it's all labelled and everything. So it just says Presta and Schrader, and you just choose which end you want. Whereas this one, perhaps a failing of my favourite pump so far, is you have to undo this thing and then you have to flip a thing inside it out, and there's a bit of a faff. This one
yeah.
had a completely detachable thing, yeah. which I've lost. So total fail on that front.
I think most pumps convert, don't they, by unscrewing and flicking it round and then putting it back
yeah.
together.
And it is a faff. So, yeah. like, if you've got one with a hose like that, that's good. So choose which sort of valves you're going to need. Another feature is whether or not they have a hose and how they yeah. attach to the valve. Yeah. So,
that's a
like,
hose as well, doesn't it?
Having a hose is really good because as you're pumping, you're not putting any pressure on the valve.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, this one, you put it on and you lock it on like that, and that does give a really nice tight attachment. But then you have to be careful that you hold this end still. You don't kind of saw yeah. on it because you can waggle it.
Yeah.
This one doesn't have any locking feature at all, so that's even more like, oh, you've got to hold it just in the right place.
Yeah. I think that one, I suppose, is possibly aimed at road cyclists who would keep that in a jersey pocket, wouldn't they, I
yeah.
suppose?
Small enough.
To put on
yeah.
there like a proper emergency pump, which has its place, certain rides and races.
So, yeah, and then another thing you might want to look for is a bleed valve, which this one does have.
So okay,
a little,
yeah.
little bleed valve on the end there. That's super useful. If you go too far, then you can just press the bleed valve,
yeah.
let the air back out. Whereas with this one, you've got to take it off the valve, go yeah. on the end of your valve, and then put it back on.
Your bleed valve's good for when you're pumping up a tubeless system that has repaired itself and gone soft, and you kind of pump it up to check whether it's in a hold, and you can let some air out, so it's kind of your
yeah.
finger squidge pressure. That's your pressure gauge, isn't it?
And then one other thing I'd say is the ergonomics of it.
Yeah, like the handles of them and things. What is good and bad? Like what's
so finger trapping
yeah.
is the thing. Yeah. Like, oh, the disproportionate pain of catching, particularly a cold finger yeah. on the trail
yeah.
in your pump.
Yeah.
So, like this one, you're not really going to put your finger in there because it's got plenty to hold on
yeah.
and it overlaps. Some of them, like, end against one another
yeah.
and then, like, oh, God, so yeah. painful. This one has a little handle that folds out and then a foot as well.
So yeah, foot pump, yeah.
It effectively turns it into a mini track pump on the trail. And again, yeah. as you're pumping, you see yeah. it stops there. Whereas I've had some of these where you get like all set up to really pump and then you just trap your finger yeah. in between there and there. Oh, gosh, so painful. So decide what bikes you want to use it
yeah.
for. Beside the circumstances that you're likely to be
yeah.
using it. Like, is it just kind of a nice to have to stop you having to push home, or is it life-saving out on the trail because you're going to get hypothermia?
Good brands are worth staying with. I mean, less is more, so it can be quite hard to choose a pump, I think, because you think, why am I paying 20 quid for this
one? It's not going to be hard now, because we've told them
quid.
What to look
but
for.
But yeah, don't get one for 5 quid that has the same lack of features as one that's from a decent brand, because things that are happening inside the pump that you can't see is where all the money is. And you can get spares and things like that on Tope, people,
yeah.
Blackburn and Lazine.
Zine ones are totally rebuildable, aren't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, all the decent brands are good.
So,
for that sort of thing.
Yep, so go out there, do your filter.
And you definitely need one, I suppose, don't you? That's one thing to say. You don't go mountain biking without some kind of inflation very far from home, or it will go wrong.
Now, some will say that you don't need one of these and you just need a CO2 canister. Do you have views on that?
I do ride most rides with a CO2 canister on my house, but I can see my house most of the time while I'm on the ride. Where I do go out, I've tried to rely on CO2 canisters enough times to know that it's a 50-50. Really, isn't it? I mean, maybe it's just practice and not being so good at them, but they're all right, but I certainly wouldn't do anything where you've gone somewhere and you want to spend the whole day riding and then, oh, I can't go any further because I've relied on a CO2. That's before getting into the reusability stakes and all
yes,
that kind of thing.
That's my quibble with them, is that they're just disposable stuff. And
yeah.
I like these because you can use them again and again and again, and you can rescue other people as well, which always,
yeah.
always feels good.
Right, we've been talking about pumps. All these pumps here are our own pumps. We've brought in some good, some bad. Hannah, which is your pump and which is the one that you like the most?
Well, this is my pump, and
yep.
this is the one that I've been using for a long while.
What and is it?
It is a Mountain TT Twin Turbo by
Topeak.
Yeah. I've been kind of talking evangelically about this pump on the trail for quite some time because, like I say, every time I've loaned it to anyone, they've been like, oh, wow, it's really efficient. And it does reinflate your tyres really quickly. However, having been here today, I'm slightly eyeing up those Lazine ones with a super easy press-to-shredder swap.
I do like this one, but I need to swear by that one. But then
and that's what, a
else,
mini morph?
That's had another Topeak mini morph, like the mini foot pump one. That's quite good. But then someone I encountered on a ride had one of these, and I used this. I thought, that's absolutely well good, because it's basically an old traditional road pump you used to keep on your top tube underneath two pegs like that, put through a shrinkalizer from Danger Mouse, and that's just so good.
Yeah.
Because I used to break a lot of valves by pumping them up in a bit of a semi-rage or just not being very careful with them. And Presta valves, pros, cons, they aren't particularly tough things, are they? So it's good that it takes all the strain out of that.
I have realised in doing this video that I actually have, from my roadie days, believe it or not, I had roadie days, I have another Lazine mini pump, and it's like, it is a roadie, titchy tiny one.
Yeah.
And it wasn't so good for on the mountain bike because it just took too much pumping. However, I'm now wondering whether maybe I should just dig it out, put up with the RSI, or buy a slightly bigger one like that.
Yeah. Yep.
Cool.
All right.
So we've been through a bunch of the features that you can find on a pump, and some of them are more useful than others. Hopefully now you're a bit better informed about when you go shopping. Off you go. Choose your pump. Bye.
Bye.